led the way. Follow in my steps.
Well, good morning, Bethel Church! All right, who's ready to continue our series, In Step? Who's ready to get more in step with Jesus today? Amen? Anybody with me? Anybody excited to hear the Word of God today? You know, I absolutely love, to minister. I love it. I never get tired of it. Now, I get tired from doing it sometimes, but I never get tired of it. I feel His pleasure. I feel His pleasure. And I'm just excited that God allows me to minister more than just here on Sunday. And this is probably one of my favorite places because I'm loved. You love me and I love you. And it's wonderful to preach in a place where people love you. And I feel that love. And so I feel God's pleasure doing it. But just wherever there's a door that God opens and I get invited, I'm there. You know, I really don't need to know if I'm supposed to go. I don't need to really pursue God and ask Him, God, should I go? The question I really need to ask God, and what you need to do in asking God, is, do I stay? Because God already said go. You know that? He already said go. So really, the question, the prayer is, God, should I stay? Because you already said go. Amen? And so let God live in a way that God has your yes before you're even asked. Make that decision. Jesus, you have my yes. Come on, just even say that. Jesus, you have my yes. Amen. And then follow up, Pastor Mike, you have my yes. Okay. So today, it's an important day. Today, Bethel, is the day we declare a war on shame. Today, we are going to declare war on shame. And with the power of the Holy Spirit, we are going to drive shame out of our lives, off of our lives, and off of as many lives as God will allow us to. Amen? You know, we've all heard the phrase, and it may have been spoken over you, and I'm sorry if it has. But today's a day to get shame off of you. Even as some have said in the past, shame on you. And I won't ask for a show of hands in case the person next to you is the one who said it. But if you haven't heard shame on you, you've heard of others putting shame on people. Shame is a tool of the enemy. God came to get shame off of us. Yes. Now, the answer to getting shame off of our lives and out of our lives is not to remove what is shameful. Not to rename what's shameful, rather. It's not to lower the bar and say the things that are shameful that they're no longer shameful. That's not the answer. That's the world's answer to shame. And then, of course, it replaces it with its own shame accusations. And we know that the scripture says in the last days, people will call what is actually evil, what is shameful, good. And then they will call what is good shameful. We're living in those days, church. We're living in those days. And if there was ever a time that we would rise up and get shame off of our lives, because shame will keep you from your destiny. Shame will keep you from fulfilling God's purposes for your life. Shame will keep you from being in step with what God says about you. In fact, shame, not guilt, I believe, keeps you from reading your Bible? Shame. I feel shame. I don't want to go to the Bible because I feel shame. And shame, as we're going to see, has to do with who you are. Where guilt has to do more with what you've done. Shame, on the other hand, emphasizes who you are. And we'll get into more of definition of the two. But before we do, turn with me to Micah chapter 7, verse 8. Micah chapter 7, verse 8. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will rise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me. Let's pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray that shame would come off of your people. That shame would come off of our lives. And God, that we wouldn't sit in it any longer. But God, we would move forward. We would get in step with our new nature, with what you say about us. And we'd stop listening to what our conscience says that's contrary to what you say. And that we'd stop listening to what others have said. And God, that we'd stop listening to the devil and what he says. For God, your word says, for those who are in you, there is no condemnation. You are not condemning us. We are not guilty. And thus, we will not identify with our old life. The old is gone. The new is here. And God, you make all things new. Holy Spirit, open our eyes, open our ears to the truth. Let us have a better understanding of what guilt is and what shame is. Reveal any area of our life, any way of thinking that involves shame. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen and amen. Recently, the Surgeon General, with great alarm, is sounding the alarm, the trumpet, that we have an epidemic in our country, an epidemic of loneliness and despair, of isolation, an epidemic of the lack of connectedness. The enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. The enemy comes to divide. The reason God hates sin is not because, sorry to steal this, Pastor Tim, not because he hates people. For God so loves people and the world that he sent his only begotten Son to save the world. To save the world from what God hates. God hates sin. Why? No, it's not because he's a cosmic killjoy. No, it's not. God made you to experience joy. God made you to experience pleasure. The devil wants to counterfeit that. He wants, in the short term, to convince you, deceive you into thinking that this temporary pleasure is what you really want. And in the short term, it might give you a dopamine hit. But in the long term, you're broken. And lust is never satisfied. And then you can't even enjoy what's enjoyable. This is why God hates sin, because it breaks relationship with him and with one another. This is why we hate it. Because it breaks relationship. And sin brings shame. brings shame. And shame, it's like a cancer, bringing destruction to your soul, to relationships all around you. Church, we must repent if we have used this tool of shame against people. It's not a tool in which God wants us to use. God wants us to bring his light and to bring his love and expose the shame. And if you or if I fall down, we get back up. Proverbs 24:16 says, "For a righteous man falls seven times, and seven times he rises again." See, when you fall, guilt acknowledges that you messed up. But shame wants to come into that falling and define you. Shame wants to stay on you. And if you don't get shame off of you, that which you shame or ashamed of will happen again and again and again. Why? Because we know that we as Christians, we do not have a sin problem. Our problem's not falling. Our problem is forgetting who we are. Our problem is an identity issue. And if we fall, we get back up. And we just acknowledge, yeah, I fell. You know, there have been times I've even acknowledged, devil, that was a good one, devil. That was a good one. You got me. You got me. But you better not gloat, because you're going back under my feet. You're going back under my feet where you belong. And it's not by my might nor by my power, but it's by the Spirit of God. So by the finger of God, get under my feet in Jesus' name. Yeah, okay, I messed up. Own it. That's not who I am. That's not who you are. You are a man or woman of God. Now turn to your neighbor and tell him that. That's who you are. You're a man or woman of God if you've given your life to Jesus. And if you haven't given your life to Jesus, I've got good news for you. You can today. Today can be the day of salvation. Today can be the beginning of a new day of your life, where the old and all the mistakes and all the guilt and the shame can be washed away. Can be washed away. Why is this such an alarming thing, this loneliness and isolation in America today? Because it has consequences. You can see it all around us. But let me tell you what the Surgeon General has connected to this epidemic, this disease, this tragedy. Physical health consequences of poor or insignificant connection relationally include a 29% increase risk of heart disease. 29% increase of heart disease. When you are living isolated and lonely lives, and here's the thing, you can be amongst people, You can be even married and be living isolated. Ladies, you're much better at this than us guys are, but to be authentic. To be authentic. Men, let me help you with being authentic. It's just being honest. And shame will keep you from being honest. But shame lifts when you walk into the light. And if you don't, the risk of heart disease goes up 29% instantly. There's a 32% increase risk of stroke. A 32% risk of stroke when you are not connected relationally. I mean, if those didn't motivate you, let me give you the one that should. Without a doubt. When you are not connected relationally, if you do not value community and relationship, which is what the church is for, community and relationship, so that we can continue to go out and invite more people into this authentic and real relationship. The church has got to stop being a restaurant. The church has got to be all about relationship. And yes, I know it's hard. And I know if you've lived in the church any period of time, you've never been loved more than in the church. And I know simultaneously, you've probably never been hurt more. Because you only really get hurt by somebody you've been transparent with, that you've been vulnerable with, that you've been honest with, that you actually love. And God uses those around you to work out those things. Do you know my wife is one of the greatest instruments of healing in my life? Healing in my life that I was clueless I needed. And you've heard me say this before. It's easy for the Pope to be infallible. He's not married, okay? But God uses my wife to save me from my old self and trigger my old self. Don't be a tool of the enemy. When your friend, when your spouse acts out on their old nature, don't define them by that. Don't define them. In fact, be shocked. Whoa, whoa, wait. Who? That's not you. That's not my loving, kind, respectful, gentle, kind, serving wife. Julie, where are you? We're not denying the facts of wrong behavior. We're just using spiritual eyes to expose and to call out what is true. What's true is my wife is a woman of God who is self-control and an amazing cook and meets my needs all the time. It's true with who she is. She tells me what's true. She encourages me. She builds me up. And those things are true. Now, when how she's living doesn't line up with that, I'm not defining her by the contrary. I'm defining her by what, who she is.
That's right. So good.
Identity. Identity is so important, church. Knowing who you are. So, Did I give the 50% or no, I didn't. Oh, here, okay, the cliffhanger. Here we go, back to, okay. You need motivation to connect and get in relationship and to work out relationship. This one is gonna do it. Because if you don't, according to the Surgeon General, you will have a 50% increase risk of developing dementia. Increase of losing your mind. Yeah, let that sink in. Let that scare you for a moment. Relationships matter. In fact, gentlemen, don't divorce your wife unless you want to die 13 years premature. That's the stat. You know that? Yeah. The longest going study by Harvard, it's been going since 1932. Four different professors have been leading it. They've been tracking students from Harvard and tracking other people that were living in Boston at the time, tracking longevity and health and success in their lives to go, what are the determining factors? And they've been interviewing every 2 years the participants, over 632 participants. And what they have found, without a doubt, it's not even close, the determining factor of longevity and happiness and health in life is relationship. And the health of your relationships. More than smoking, drinking, any other behavior. Relationships. It's the most watched TED Talk, the professor. You can watch it yourself. It's amazing. It's the most important thing. And church, here's the thing. It's why God created you. It's why Jesus came to die, to restore relationship, to offer forgiveness to us, and that we, having received that forgiveness, can offer it to others. Now, I know I talked about men, look, and being in a terrible relationship actually doesn't help. It's got to be not a perfect one, but it has to be one that there's life-givingness in it. And ladies, you will live 6 years less not being in a healthy, committed relationship. That's just, those are the facts. Now, we know that you can experience covenant, intimate relationships without being married. But how are you going to do that without the church? You won't. You can't. See, we're in covenant with one another. We're in covenant with one another. And Jesus is the security of that relationship. And so be motivated today to go, relationship matters. And now, Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So let me define shame and guilt a little bit more, okay? Because they have a lot of similarities to them. Shame focuses on our inherent worth as individuals. It is a pervasive feeling of inadequacy, embarrassment, self-disgust. When we experience shame, we believe that there is something fundamentally wrong with who we are. It attacks our identity, making us feel unworthy of love, acceptance, and belonging. Shame keeps us stuck in negative self-perception and can lead to isolation and self-destructive behavior. This is why I come today to declare that we declare a war on shame. Because shame isolates us. Shame keeps us from authentic, real, and healthy relationships. Shame does. Shame keeps us from having intimacy with God the Father. Shame keeps us from having intimacy with our wives, with our kids, with our friends. Shame does. And shame wants to tell you you're bad. Not that the behavior's bad. Wants to say you're bad. And here's the news is, before Jesus, you were bad. And occasionally you did what was right. So it's true, you are bad. Humanity has a disease. It's called sin. And that sin separates us from God. And the best the world can do is try to manage that. But Jesus has a solution for it, to remove it and to give you a new heart and make you good. Today, some of you need to hear this. You are good. Even right now, just in your breath, go, I'm good. I'm good. If Jesus is in you, you're good. You're a new creation. All things have been made new. The old is gone. The new is here. You're a new creation and you are good. And even though you're good now, you occasionally still do what's bad. And when you do, you feel guilt. And that's okay, because you can ask for forgiveness. Guilt, on the other hand, centers around our actions and behaviors. It arises when we believe we have done something wrong or violated our moral or ethical standards. Guilt is often accompanied by a sense of remorse or regret for a specific action or decision we made. Unlike shame, guilt allows us to separate our actions from our identity. It can't motivate us to make amends, or it can motivate us to make amends, seek forgiveness, and strive for positive change. Here's the thing. When you and I allow shame to come on our lives, we will not repent. We will make it about us. It's baffling to me. It's like, you wronged me. And you're isolating. I mean, Pastor Rice taught me this years ago. If you want somebody out of your life, okay, you want to get them out of your life, loan them enough money that they can't pay you back. Guaranteed, out of your life. Here's the amazing thing. I have given money. I've loaned people money. I've never charged interest, but I've loaned them money. They say, hey, if you can help me out, loan this money, and I'll give it back to you. And they give me a date. I'm like, great. They're going to give it back to me. You know, no problem. I give it. But in my mind, I never give something or loan something I'm not willing to lose and not let it affect the relationship. If I'm not willing and I'm not mature enough to say, if he doesn't give it back to me, I'll let it go and I will not let it affect the relationship. But here's what I found out. Unfortunately, even when I forgive and I let it go, it affects the relationship. They're no longer guilty. I've released them of the guilt. I'm like, bro, it's done. No problem. Let's just move on. You know, no problem. Let's just move on. And yet, they take on the shame. And that shame keeps us from having a good relationship. Now, that shame's theirs. It's not from me. It's self-clothed. It's self-clothed. You are self-condemning. Shame has to do with you putting it on. You're putting on shame after guilt. Guilt is, these are bad actions. I'm going to get right. I'm going to do right. I can change that. I'm going to make up for what I did. And if I can't, and I'm forgiven, what it should produce afterwards is, Mike, man, you are amazing. You got a more loyal friend than before. Like, I know how much you love me and care for me. And we're closer. But shame makes us further. So sometimes I'm like, man, I don't want to break this relationship. I don't want to give you this money. Because I love our relationship. Now I still do. And unfortunately, it still has that ramification at times. But if somebody's in need and I have the means to help, I gotta help. But I'll tell you over and over again, it has affected relationship, unfortunately. But know this, if I ever give you money, or if I ever do, I'm not going to hold it over you. In fact, all I'm going is I just invested in you. And the result should be that of which there's a stronger bond. And this is what should happen with our relationship with God. If we fall, if we make a mistake, and there's guilt from it, we receive forgiveness and we repent, because the reason we needed forgiveness was we did the wrong thing. We were going in the wrong direction, right? We forgot who we were. See, because a man of God, a woman of God wouldn't have done that. And I forgot. See, I used to have a strong identity as an athlete. Okay? Walked around high school. I'm the jock, you know. And, you know, praise God I didn't take on the identity that I needed to have bad grades. Okay? But there were certain things, Pastor Tim, that I didn't do because I was an athlete. Like, I never smoked. Right? Why, Daniel? Because it would affect my athletes don't smoke. And athletes do certain things. Like, they work out. They eat a lot of protein, right? My identity changed my behavior. This is the same thing that's true about you and I. You're a Christian, you're a man of God, you're a woman of God. And so you live differently because your identity's changed. You have a new ID. Stop using the false ID. But if you fall, devil, laugh all you want. Because your days are numbered. Your days are numbered. And you want to remind me of my past? Go ahead. I'm just going to remind you of your future. So yeah, okay, you're right. Did it wrong. But why is it so hard? And why do we get triggered so much when we mess up? I think it's because it hits an area of our life where there's a lot of shame. And not all shame is because of what you've done. Many times there's a lot of shame in our lives because of what's been done to us. But here's the good news. Jesus can take care of both. Jesus can take care of both. Again, the answer to shame is not to redefine what's shameful and not shameful. God has already defined that. The answer is to let God forgive you and do what you can to make up with those that you've done wrong against. And then when things get triggered, when the devil uses this bait that attracts some old wound in your life, some old thing in your life, and it gets exposed, it's like, oh, okay, I feel some shame. I need to deal with this. Jesus wants to go in to those areas of your soul that nobody's gone in. You're afraid to even go into those areas. I know I am. There's some areas I'm like, oh man, I don't want to go there. But if you don't let him go there, the enemy will always have the opportunity to bait you. And you will be tempted. Now the good news is this, and this isn't to shame you, but Jesus said he'll never let you be tempted beyond what you can handle. Which kind of at first can bring shame. Can it? Like, dang. So I don't have an excuse. Right? I can't go, the devil made me do it. The devil tempted you to do it. And the devil influenced, but he never made you. Because God will not let you be tempted beyond what the grace of God can do to cause you to not do it. In fact, many people don't understand what the grace of God is for. Many people think the grace of God is for my guilt, but it's actually not. Mercy is for your guilt. Mercy is God does not hold me accountable. He does not hold against me what I've done wrong. That's mercy, that I don't get what I deserve. That's mercy. Grace, on the other hand, according to Titus 2:11, grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness and its worldly passions. Grace gives us the power to say, no, devil, speak to the hand. Not today, devil, not today. That's the grace of God. That's the grace of God in your life. And the Bible says, see to it that you don't miss the grace of God. Don't miss it. Don't miss God's favor. Don't miss it. But here's the deal. We all do, don't we? Have you ever missed God's grace since you've been a Christian? Since you've been married more than a week? Has your spouse missed the grace of God? The answer, yes. And we may miss the grace of God in the future. In fact, there's a really good chance we're going to miss it. But we have a Savior. We have a Redeemer. We have a Healer who can fix us, who can forgive us, and who can give us a second chance. Yesterday in our 50-day devotional, in-step devotional, we reread John chapter 20 and 21. And so I want to refer to John 21. And if you haven't been keeping up with the devotional, shame on you. Okay? I'm kidding. But here's the thing on that for a moment. You miss a day, you feel shame. And that shame will actually cause you to miss a second day. And then a third day and a fourth. Shame influences us to not be who we are. You're a disciplined man or woman of God. You are his child. You are the apple of God's eye. You are loved, blessed, and highly favored. That's who you are. And shame wants to put a wet blanket on that truth. Shame wants to clothe you. And today is a day to take shame off and put him on. And that's the journey every day. But anyway, this week, we're reading through the book of Acts as we're prepping for this amazing day of Pentecost, where we're offering two services. Well, we always offer two services in the Sunday morning, but we have our special worship night that you saw, where we're joining 100 million Christians that have been praying and are coming together to pray and to worship, to believe God for a revival for Israel and for the Jewish people. And the day of Pentecost is a day that you're gonna hear this in a moment, to empower us to overcome shame. But back to John chapter 21 that you read yesterday. Story of Peter. Peter, who had denied Jesus 3 times. Peter, who Jesus was entrusting the leading of the early church to, who called Peter out of being a fisherman to being a fisher for men. Peter, who got to be invited to the Mount of Transfiguration, where he got to see the manifestation of Old Testament saints and the glory of God. Peter, who got to be part of the inner three. Peter, who had the revelation that Jesus was the Son of God, the Messiah, right? Peter, who said, hey, all these other disciples, they may desert you, but not me. And Jesus said, Peter, the devil wants to sift you, but I am praying that you will have strength and that you will not be sifted. But Peter, you will deny me 3 times before the rooster crows. And shortly after that, in Jesus' time of greatest need, Jesus' right-hand guy denies even knowing him 3 times. Can you imagine the amount of shame of that moment that he must have felt afterwards? Three days later, Jesus resurrects. He seeks out Peter. He loves Peter. We don't have any history that Jesus came to Peter and said, hey, told you so. I can't imagine Jesus doing such a thing. Can you? No. He goes, guys, it's me. It's me, resurrected. What I said came true. Not that you guys failed me, but that I have saved you. That I am the Messiah. You can trust me. And they trust him. But then in John chapter 21, a week to 10 days later, Jesus comes to the disciples. He comes to the disciples, specifically Peter, while they're fishing. See, Peter, now I'm about to enter into some of my strong opinions about this, okay? So you need to understand this. I'm reading into the story here, but I think we need to read into stories. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us about some of the details that are going on. Not to teach with authority that my interpretation, what I'm hearing is God, but that the Holy Spirit's speaking to me. And so Peter's out fishing. He returns because he forgot who he was. He forgot he was called to be fishers of men. But shame will cause us to return to our vomit. Shame will cause us to forget who we are. Peter, my opinion, forgot who he was, went fishing. But Jesus, you can't get rid of Jesus. Once he goes in covenant with you, good luck. You're stuck with him. You don't invite him inside, he's at the door knocking. He's at the door knocking, the Bible says. Going, let me in. Come on, I'm here. Lover of your soul, the one who saved you, the one who loves you, unconditionally, I'm still here. And here's the thing. If Jesus is knocking on your door and you hear him and you don't let him in, is that not shameful? And Jesus is not knocking going, shame on you. But every one of us knows Jesus is knocking. Shame gets off of you if you just open the door. Jesus comes to Peter. They have a problem. They can't catch any fish. Jesus says, hey guys, you got any fish? No. Hey, throw your net out on the other side. Giant catch of fish. John says, it's Jesus. Peter clothes himself. So I'm going to give you my opinion why we have those details. He clothes himself, jumps in the water, swims as fast as he can to Jesus. The details in the story, I can't say this for sure, but what I think is shame wants to cover itself. See, I believe Peter went fishing because he was ashamed of what he had done. And who could blame him, right? We all know how shameful that would be. We'd all experience that. It is shameful to deny Jesus. See, the answer is not to go, oh, Peter, don't be ashamed. That's ridiculous. It is shameful. That's what's ridiculous about us going into the world going, oh, no, no, it's okay. It's okay to be a pedophile. It's okay. I don't want you to be ashamed. That's ridiculous. Sin is shameful. Church, it's time to stop calling those things that are evil good. And what's good, evil. This is what's going on in the world, but it shouldn't be going on in the church. God doesn't hate people. He hates sin. You must, if you're going to be a follower of Jesus, hate sin. Because that which you don't hate, you will tolerate. And there are certain things in this world, church, we cannot tolerate. That's how change comes. Jesus is not coming to shame you. He's coming to get shame off of you. And Jesus came to get shame, I believe, off of Peter. But you can't cover your shame. It's like you're dirty and you put on a clean coat. You're still dirty. He's the only one that can make you clean. And he's the only one that can clothe you with righteousness. Scripture says in John 20 that Jesus is cooking fish on a charcoal fire. Just a few days earlier, the Bible describes Peter standing by a charcoal fire while he denies Jesus. There are only two times in all of the Bible that describe a fire as a charcoal fire. Go ahead. Feel free for the handful of you that want to make sure that's true. Only two places. The place in which Peter denies Jesus and the place in which Jesus restores Jesus. Where Jesus restores Peter. Why? Why are there details in there? I believe because our sense of smell is one of which is so connected to memory. See Peter walking up going, you know, it's Jesus. Now here's the thing. The reason too, I think Jesus is dealing with shame and not guilt, because we have a similar story 3.5 years earlier when Jesus called Peter out of being a fisherman into being a fisher of men. The story where Jesus comes to Peter who had fished all night, caught nothing. Similarities, right? And Jesus goes, guys, go out again, cast your net. He's like, ugh. Reluctantly, Peter goes out, he casts the net. And guess what? They catch a big catch where the net's gonna tear. The new net doesn't tear because the new wine doesn't tear. Okay, that's just other symbols, but I think opinion there again. But here it is. What was Peter's response during the first catch? Away from me, Jesus. I'm a wicked man. That's guilt. He was guilty. The second catch, Peter's not guilty. He's jumping. He's swimming as fast as he can to Jesus. But when we get to Jesus, sometimes he wants to deal with our shame. He wants to deal with our shame. And Jesus says, Peter, do you love me? Yeah, I love you. Feed my lambs. Again, he asks, Jesus, do you love me? Yeah, I love you. Feed my sheep. And the third time, Jesus, do you love me? This time it says, Peter was hurt. Church, I can't sugarcoat this. Sometimes getting healed is going to be painful. But you are more than a conqueror. This is why we try to avoid it. This is why I don't want to talk about my feelings. Because sometimes my feelings have pain. I don't want to face those feelings. Why? Because I don't want to go back to moments in my life that produced pain. But if you don't, the devil has access to pull on that, to trigger that. And you'll never become all that you're called to be. You gotta get honest, church. And I'm not talking about, we're gonna deal with it all, Daniel, today, right now. We're going to every issue, every time, you know, when the coach yelled at you, that time we're gonna go there too. We're gonna go there. No, we can't handle that. We'd implode, okay? It's just one issue at a time in this journey with Jesus. But if we don't face the truth, if we don't get honest, shame will rule our lives. Which will lead to isolation, which can lead to heart disease, strokes, premature death, church. So what are you going to do? going to join me and declare war on shame? Because it's not just you who needs this. It's not just you that shame needs to get off. But there's a shame that's destroying our nation. There's a shame that's destroying our families. There's a shame that's destroying our world. And Jesus did not come to condemn the world, to shame the world, but to save the world. So what will you do? What will you do now that you know the truth? Will you let the truth set you free? Or will you continue to let shame rule your lives? For me and my house, shame has no chance. It's going to be driven out. It's not a tool that I'm going to use in my house. It's not going to be a tool that we use in this house. We're going to get shame off of people. And Jesus is the only way. He's the answer. Listen, right now, there's probably things flowing through going, man, I did this. Nobody even knows. Let's just get real. I don't have it here, but computer, phone. We've all engaged in shameful things. But he wants to set us free. And those things that you engaged in, it's not who you are. Men and women of God, we are not perverted. We're not. We are people of purity. We are not perverted people. Men and women of God, we are not gossipers. Men and women of God, we are not addicts. It's not who you are. Care what AA tells you. If you're born again, that's not who you are. I'm not telling you to go drink. Don't drink. That's not who you are. You are who God says you are. You're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, seated with Him in heavenly places. You are loved, you are blessed, and you are highly favored. Why do I say it over and over and over again? Because the world is saying the opposite, saying you are unloved. You are not happy. You are not fortunate. And that everybody's against you. That's what the world says. This summer, we're going to start a series called Castaway. The Lord knew what this world needed in setting this series up for us. It all has to do with isolation. Many of you that are older remember the movie Tom Hanks and Castaway, don't you? Yeah, Wilson will be visiting us. Let's pray, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, we can come to you. You are a good, good Father. God, you're not ashamed of us. And that's amazing. It's amazing, Father, that you're not ashamed of us today. You love us. And you don't see our sin. And you certainly are not going to remind us of our sin. But God, you want us to believe what's true and that we are new creations. You know, if you're here today and you haven't given your life to Jesus you do feel regret and you feel shame from things you've done, Jesus is here to forgive you and to remove the shame and to clothe you. So if you desire to follow Jesus and you desire for this love and forgiveness and the removal of that shame, would you lift up your hand? Because I want to pray with you. I want to stand with you. Amen. 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 You can put your hands down. As our eyes are closed, heads are bowed, if you, during this message, would say, man, Pastor, you got me. I know I got shame in my life. But I want shame off of my life. I want it off. You be honest enough to say, yeah, I deal with shame. And I want it removed. Would you lift up your hand? Because I want to pray with you. Right now, just lift it up. You say, yes, I know shame has been triggered in my life. I know there's shame in my life that I want to be removed. Come on. Today is the day to have shame off of you, to have it removed today. You gotta be honest. You gotta be honest. The only way that I know of to get the shame of things that we've done in our past off is to be honest about them. Be honest today. I know I'm a little over time, but this is such an important moment. Don't let this moment pass by and not have shame removed from your life. You don't have to live under it. You don't have to let it rule you. You can come out of the prison. The door has been opened. The chains have fallen off. Walk into the light. Rise up. Rise up. So God, you've seen all the hands. You know all the lives. Church, pray this. We would say, Jesus, I surrender my life. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for washing away my sins, for throwing my sin into the sea of forgetfulness, not to be remembered again, buried forever. You don't hold it against me, Lord. Jesus, I confess, you are my Lord and Savior. And I am not ashamed of you. And I'm not ashamed to say you're my Savior and my Lord. And I throw shame off. And I clothe myself with your righteousness and your Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us for service today. Excited to have you. And remember, you matter to us and you matter to God. And because you matter to us, we want to connect with you. So please be sure to fill out a connect card and let us know how we can be praying for you this week. And we'll see you here next week.
Now check out these announcements. We'll be right back.
to invite you out for an awesome summer of life.
You got life groups that are going to make your summer fun. We're going to have some adventure groups, men's groups, women's group, marriage group.
Don't take a vacation from God.
If you would like to give, we invite you to give through the Bethel app, available through your app store. Whether new to Bethel or one of our members, we want you to know that we are all about relationship. So connect with us. Press connect and let us know how you're doing. And if you need prayer, well, we can pray for you. Press pray with us and one of our ministry staff will take on your prayer request. Digitally challenged? Well, don't worry. We have gift envelopes and connect cards located in the seat back in front of you. And if you are connecting with us online, simply download the Bethel app or visit our website at www.bethelchandler.com.
To find out more about what's happening here at Bethel, register for events, or listen to the latest sermon, download the Bethel app or visit our website at www.bethelchandler.com.